I've no doubt that it's in man's instinct to go where no man has ever been before and to discover new things and to explore new things, whether it's outer space, underwater, climbing mountains or caving. Once he ceases to do these things, he really ceases to become man. He'll just become a cabbage and a nothing.
Beneath these convoluted rocks on a plateau high in the French Pyrenees lies a vast underground world. A world made by water, scarring and whirling and dripping through soluble limestone, a world measureless to man. Man, with his insatiable curiosity, must probe where no other man has been, must establish finite limits, and this, he thinks, is the deepest hole in the world. It lies near the mountainous border between Spain and France, above the village of Saint-Engrasse, in the land of the Basque. Last year, a motley collection of British cavers, most of them from Yorkshire, a county which has its own limestone caverns, arrived in the valley. There was no ballyhoo, no vast mounds of equipment transported by an army of porters, no sponsorship, no flag waving. Just a group of friends, rolling along to join the expedition and try to push the hole still deeper, to tread where no man had been before. For centuries, this has been a pastoral valley, a valley that led nowhere except to a few scattered farms and to the village of Saint-Engrasse. Few strangers ever came here, just the occasional hunter who came to shoot wolves or bears or wild boars. The potholes on the plateau above the village were of no use to the villagers themselves, for didn't they believe that they were occupied by evil spirits and that they led straight down to hell? But then came the speleologists, the cavers with their strange passions.
As far as I'm concerned, caving has virtually taken over my life, in effect. You sort of live and you breathe it. Work is only a matter of paying the bills, of getting the money to live by, and of course, to save a little money to have the occasional expedition abroad once a year.
And so they come, from Leeds and Bradford and Barnsley, to this remote French valley, bringing with them their cheap English food. And here they'll stay until their money, £20, perhaps even £30, saved throughout the winter, has run out. For this is the mecca of the expert caver, the place where men like the Brooks brothers can make the deepest cave in the world still deeper.
It's on such an incredible scale that it's incomprehensible, really, to somebody who's caved in Yorkshire. The actual grandeur of the place, you know, the scale of it, it's just unbelievable.
Dave Gill, a thin man from Derbyshire.
It's difficult to say why one likes the Pierre Saint Martin compared to other caves. Probably it's so large. Potentially, it could go to, 6,000 feet deep. So it's got great potential.
Dave Yendel, known as Pooh, perhaps because he is rotund around the middle.
In fact, this trip is the equivalent of the southwest face of Everest, because it's the most technically difficult caving trip in the world, and just as Everest is the highest mountain in the world, this is the deepest pothole, and it's going to be fantastic being a part of the incredible history of the Pierre Saint Martin.
That history began at the beginning of this century in the Pyrenees, a mountain range with a great preponderance of limestone, a rock so soluble in water that rivers can suddenly disappear into the ground and emerge again many miles away. This so fascinated a Belgian, Max Cosins, an atomic physicist, a balloonist, and a speleologist, that he has devoted a lifetime to the mystery of this one river, a river which emerges crystal clear and icy cold from a hole in the side of a canyon.
You see that cave and that waterfall? I've been here for the first time 54 years ago in 1918, and I fall in love at first sight with the caves here, and since then it has been a source of challenge between the caves and myself to try to find from where the water comes. We try several times to enter the siphons by diving, but without success.
Repeated attempts to explore upwards were repulsed time and time again. But the water had to come from somewhere. So in the mid-1930s, they switched their attention to the plateau, 5,000 feet higher. And there they were faced with the most complicated three-dimensional jigsaw puzzle in the world. They had to find the missing piece, the gap, the hole, that would lead into a shaft which might widen into a cavern. But the problem was that there were hundreds of missing pieces, hundreds of holes. Some went down just a few feet, some 200 feet. One plummeted into the limestone for 800 feet. But they didn't lead anywhere. They went the source of the river that came out in the gorge 5,000 feet below. They were at it for 15 years, until they knew every rock, every crevice. Then, on the very last evening of the 1950 expedition, two of the explorers were dangling their legs over some minor pothole and idly throwing stones into the shaft. A crow. A pair of crows, nesting perhaps. They always nested above a deep hole. It was, when they measured it, 1,130 feet deep. Next day, they sent a telegram to their friends. Have discovered the deepest vertical hole yet known. The expedition that was mounted in 1951 was on a grand scale. A dozen of the most experienced cavers from France, Belgium, and Italy, with specially designed equipment. Their leader, naturally, was the Belgian physicist, Max Cosins, a man obsessed with a desire to unravel the underground geography. And there was George Lepineau, the man who disturbed the crows, and Marcel Loubens, a 33-year-old Paris industrialist. It is not easy to lower a man through 1,000 feet of space from a rough camp set up on a bare plateau 5,000 feet up in the mountains. The honor of being the first man down was given to Lepineau, for it was he who had discovered the shaft, and it bore his name. His harness was adapted from a parachute and from the gear used by climbers. He is a jeweler, a trade which seems to allow him enough leisure to go exploring each summer. The most vital piece of equipment, something that had taken Max Cosins all winter to design and build, was the winch and its motive power. Pedal backwards to let the man down, forwards to bring him up again. It was diabolically hard work, even for a Frenchman whose national sport is cycling. Just to lower and raise one man down the shaft was the equivalent of cycling 100 miles. Four hours later, Lepineau was back on the surface, reporting that the shaft broke into a chamber the size of St. Paul's Cathedral. And the shaft itself was almost twice the height of our own post office tower. Two more members of the expedition made the descent, and then began to explore through caverns never seen by man before, probing in search of that elusive river. Marcel Loubens was one of the pair. He already held the world depth record set when exploring another French cavern. He was, he confessed, bitten by the speleological bug. He and his companion squeezed through a tight hole into a second, even larger chamber, and at the bottom of it they could hear the rumbling of a large river. The urge to go on was tempered by the thought of the long, towering lift back into the real world. So that was the limit for 1951. But next year they were back again with more sophisticated equipment, and again it was Marcel Loubens who was at the spearhead of the assault. After 5 days underground, feeling very tired, he asked to be hauled back up. His harness had snapped, his back was broken. For 36 hours they struggled to rescue him until a message came up the wire, Loubens is dead. His memorial, scratched into the rock, is still there 20 years later, a place of pilgrimage for members of last year's British expedition. They're going to follow Loubens's route and go beyond into all the caverns and crawls that have been discovered by successive expeditions over the past 20 years. So immense is the system that those early explorers conceived a dream. Might, they thought, be possible to harness the fall of the river to produce hydroelectricity and ease the lives of the peasants who tilled the land above their heads. A wild dream, and yet it is the power of water alone that has produced this huge system, cutting and dissolving its way through the soluble limestone. Hard rock, dissolved over millions of years by soft water, which only quietens when it reaches a bed of insoluble shale. It was here that Loubens put some fluorescein dye into the water, but he didn't live long enough to learn that it had indeed appeared days later in the gorge 4 miles away. These men who practice this strange sport have much in common with the mountaineer, the same Rabelaisian sense of humour, the same need to challenge the barriers of knowledge. And yet, to a mountaineer, caving seems to be an exercise in masochism, wet, claustrophobic, cold, and dark.
Darkness in a cave is deep and very dense. There isn't even a star, there's nothing at all.
Sometimes the stream was there, sometimes it wasn't. Narrower now and awkward. And ahead, a dull roaring noise, and then the floor dropping away into the darkness.
You come out across this fantastic expanse of blackness. Even to me, I was absolutely certain that it couldn't possibly be a natural underground cavity. You think it's night, obviously, because it's dark, so you look for stars. There isn't any. You start to think, well, we must be underground. Imagining it from the original explorers, from the bloke who actually got there first. You know, the feeling he must have had must have been absolutely incredible. Thank you.
At the bottom of this immense cavern, the water sinks into the sand, a mighty cascade swallowed into the earth again. It seemed that the Pierre Saint Martin had come to its end. Bottomed is the technical caving expression. The river was lost. No one would ever be able to follow it into the gorge. The longest vertical shaft in the world, 7 massive chambers, culminating in the Salverna. 2,389 feet from top to bottom, the world depth record for any cave in the year of 1953, the year they reached the Salverna. Even if the British did climb Everest in that year, the French could at least claim that they could lose 23 Albert Halls in here. Then the French Electricity Generating Board, the EDF, drilled a tunnel into the Salverna, only to discover that the hydroelectricity scheme wouldn't work. But the tunnel was a godsend to cavers. Using it, they could push their exploration onwards into the Puy-Parment. And later still, explorations were pushed in the opposite direction, up beyond the Lepineau shaft to a higher entrance, the Tête Sauvage. A mammoth system, 12 miles in length. The calculations for the depth of a cave are complex. Take the lowest point reached by man and work back to the highest entrance, and that gives you the world depth record. It was this record that the British had come to attack, and their first attempt will be in the Puy-Parment. If you want to attack the highest mountain in the world, you will need tens of thousands of pounds, government licenses, famous names as patrons. But to attack the world depth record, all you need are some friends, a wetsuit, lengths and lengths of homemade ladders, and some sort of tacit understanding that each will do his job, and that nobody is boss. Although you could say that Dave Brooke was the first amongst equals. The British were going to make one mammoth effort. Not for them, the French approach, which took 3 years and 5 camps, to push one Frenchman to the bottom.
You got any carbide, Donny?
A bit in the tin. Looking around in some place.
How much you got? You got enough for, say, 4 or 5 pills?
Yeah.
How long do you reckon it'll take us?
Depends how it goes, really, but it could be 20 hours, at least.
You brought plenty of food on?
Oh, some chocolate.
It'll be light when we come out.
That's
the best thing, anyway.
That's the best thing, yeah. 20 hours, really. Whoops.
Is it gone?
Yep.
Good.
This was the route. An easy walk into the Salverna, and then a difficult climb, in the dark, up the far wall and into the meanders, tight and awkward passages, before the vertical descent into the Puy-Parment. Electron ladders and wetsuits are the modern caver's gear. They are called wet because they trap a thin film of water between your body and the suit. In a sense, you are kept warm by your own wetness.
Of course, there's big iron doors on the EDF tunnel to control the draft inside the cave. If you leave these open for more than a few minutes, the draft increases to a howling gale and blows the grass and the little bushes about around the entrance to the door.
When you get underground, you feel that you're, you know, really doing something that's exciting and something that's new. You know, and this is great, you feel that you're making some sort of impression.
You're not really nervous, it's apprehension more than nervousness. You know, in other words, what are you going to find? What do you expect to find? How will you go on? It's so big, so huge, so long. Anything could happen.
The first difficulty is a 350-foot rock face. The man who discovered this route was a good geologist. He remembered that when the river entered the top of the Salverna, it was flowing along a bed of shale, and that at some time in the geological past, before the Salverna was formed by a collapse, the river must have continued on top of this impervious shale. So he searched for the old riverbed and found it high in a corner.
you sense a cave. You don't just see it from one view, and it's something that's completely about you and surrounding you, and you gain an impression of it by moving through it and gradually get a three-dimensional feel of it.
They call this the meanders, as tight and difficult a passage as you can find. More a vertical slit than the passage, with the fear that if you fall, you might become wedged. Imagination must be kept under tight control. Fear in a place like this could be fatal. And surely a cave represents all the basic fears of man, the fear of height and of water and of the dark. And above all, the fear of being trapped. It would be easier without the gear, but there are ladders and lights and batteries for the filming. It isn't usually as well lit as this. A caver's normal environment is only what he can feel with his hands and feet, and see with the diffused beam of his carbide lamp.
The eternal darkness that plays a great part in the psychological aspect of caving. It's dark all the time. Well, you're always wet, virtually. You can never get dry in a cave. And of course, one of the problems is the temperature of the water. It's extremely cold. It's, what, about 1 degree above freezing. There's a howling gale, of course. So it's a really cold, damp and miserable spot. After you've been dragging a load of caving tattle along this meander Martin, by the time you get to the end, you can be physically completely exhausted. And I suppose you have to be a bit funny in the head, really, to attempt to start going down the, 700 foot of very, very wet pitches. And it can be quite a bit unnerving.
When the French reached this point, the end of the meanders, they reckoned they were approaching the limits of human endurance. Here they dumped ladders and pitched camp. But the British paused for sardines. To a mountaineer or a caver, sardines are, for some inexplicable reason, the food of delight. Now they must change direction, vertically downward, into the shaft, the Puy Parment, 800 feet of gruelling pitches.
In a cave as cold as the Pierre Saint Martin, you really can't afford to stop still for a long time, because otherwise your body temperature is going to fall very drastically and you're going to be in trouble. Everybody's got to be doing something.
Making their own heat.
Yeah. Making their own heat, yeah. Yes.
On pitches like these, they lifeline a man down, tie a rope around his body, and pay it out as he descends the ladder so that if he does slip off, or the ladder should break, he still has a chance. Ahead, the advance party have already laddered three more pitches, but always in the back of their minds is the thought of the return, of conserving enough energy to climb back up.
Everybody does their own job. You have a person who's best at rigging pitches, another person who's good at climbing, another person who's a good wriggler. He's the man for the tight bits and this sort of thing. And the whole team completely changes character for every different obstacle.
But they've all got to be good on ladders, and it is not as easy as they make it look. Only one other expedition has been as deep as this. There is a growing feeling of isolation, 8 hours of technically difficult and physically exhausting work, a feeling of being embedded beyond the reach of normal man, forgotten by the world. Now they are near the limit of known ground, and someone surely must select the equivalent of the summit pair, select the group who will go to the bottom and gather the glory.
The whole thing worked out naturally. The ones who felt the fittest and also had the strongest motivation, perhaps, that happened to be the ones who went to the bottom. But they were going down on the backs of the team who'd done all the tackle carrying beforehand. I don't think you can single them out as heroes, really.
This is as far as the cameras with their bulky battery lights can go. This is as far as we shall see them go. But there are four more pitches below this, 300 feet before they reach the known limits of the Pierre Saint Martin. And then? Well, that's what they came to explore. The rest of the party can only wait, huddled together for warmth. Hours went by, 5 hours. And then the ladder starts to move. Dave Brooke has been to the known bottom, but not into the unknown. And it was for the unknown that they came all this way. Man is always in search of virgin ground, and this time they failed to find it.
What'd you get then?
Well, you got to the bottom.
I did, you? What's down there?
And? Another 3 glorious feet.
3 feet, eh?
Yes.
What, too tight?
Yeah, we Chaz knocked these projections off.
Oh yeah.
And I managed to squeeze down a bit. But I reckon that if I force myself right through, I won't be able to get back.
You wouldn't be able to get back had you gone through the squeezer.
Yeah. It's not a place of rescue, is it?
They came to set up a new depth record, and all they've achieved so far is another 3 measly feet. They haven't solved the puzzle of the river which emerges 2,000 feet below the deepest point reached by man. So now they plan to switch their attack to another shaft, the Maria Dolores. It's nearer to their entrance point in the Sal Verna, and it's reputed to be a dead end. But that is only the word of one man who penetrated to its bottom over 10 years ago. Perhaps, in the hopeful mind of a British caver, it could lead to that elusive river. It begins with a ridiculously small hole, the sort of hole that good cavers learn never to ignore. Somewhere down there must be a river.
The main river of the Pierre Saint Martin vanishes in the bottom of the Sal Verna. If we could get back into this main river, the possibilities of finding huge extensions, you know, a huge cave system, would be quite good. And of course, by pushing the Marie Dolores deeper, we're hoping that we'll find this main river eventually.
Where the original French explorers laddered these early pitches, the British climb free. But then it's always easier, both in mountaineering and caving, for the men who are going where others have already been. Perhaps there is no greater fear than the fear of the unknown, that somebody has been down here and somebody has got back. It is always a surprising place, this Pierre Saint Martin. Just a tight squeeze, a wet descent, and the shaft seems to be opening out. This is the most frightening and spectacular pitch in the whole system, prosaically called the 230-foot pitch because you swing in dark space for 230 feet, the height of Nelson's Column, and then a bit more. And this is as far as the French ever got. A dead end, no sign of the river. but Pooh's curiosity has led him into a small, almost unnoticeable slit.
As often happens with caving, the ways on that look the least promising start to open out, and they start to go on further. So it was just a matter of descending this pitch and then seeing that it was going to go further. You know, it's a fantastic feeling when you realise as you go further and further down it that perhaps it's going to open up, and perhaps this, you know, is not just a last chance, but perhaps this is the main way on.
Appropriately, the new shaft is named after Pooh, and there are more pitches below it. Now, for the first time, they're really exploring. It's a very simple, almost primitive feeling, rare in this sophisticated world.
Well, you feel pretty elated, really, I suppose, when you you actually find something new. And when we came across a very large pitch, what appeared at the time to be something in the region of 200 foot deep, we thought we'd really hit the big stuff.
First, they have to traverse to get directly above the big pitch. And traversing is always one of the most dangerous manoeuvres, especially when the rock is loose. There is no lifeline to hold you from above. If you fall here, you pendule across the rock, and it is only too easy to become jammed.
You just don't think of the fear at the time. You're elated that it's going at that particular moment. And in fact, the only fear that you do have is that it will stop.
But surely a shaft like this isn't going to stop. A major river has been at work here. At the bottom of the impressive shaft was a stream, emerging, flowing, and then sinking into cracks. No man could go further. This was the end.
We've had disappointments, but we have in fact extended the Maria Dolores. We'll be going back again next year because it could still break the world depth record by passing over the sump by roof passages.
Man must always hope, but now it's time to go back to Yorkshire. They've impressed the French with their skill and speed. They've been to the bottom of the deepest hole in the world. They've extended the Maria Dolores by another 350 feet. But the world will not rock with the news. Yet here in the Pyrenees, this group of mates have sought and found their very own personal adventure.